So we start with the new topic today, oscillators. All of you are aware that unless there is some kind of a signal generation, be it sinusoid, be it triangular wave, be it ramp, or be it finally the square wave or rectangular wave, you need to generate signal. Many applications in analog are sinusoid oscillators are required. There are many applications in digital as well as mixed signals. You need some kind of a square wave or rectangular wave generation or pulse waves. Some other applications like synchronization, you may require ramps, but all these are not very difficult as far as the periodicity is concerned. So we are more interested in signal repeating at a given period. So that's why it's called oscillator. It changes, repeat itself after a particular period, or it has certain fixed frequency. A typical feedback system is shown here, which has the transfer function of HS, open loop gain, and if it is given a feedback, and assuming the beta network is 1, unity has a gain of unity, then a closed loop gain will be HS upon 1 plus HS. And the way it seems here, that the output is fed back to the input, because that's what beta is 1 essentially means, and it interacts with the input and forms a new output, and this process goes on. Now there are of course three possibilities, which one of course I have shown here. One is, this may be positive, this may be negative, both may be positive, this may be positive, this may be negative, and one may be stronger positive positive or stronger minus minus, which all possibility exist. One of them shown here, that actually input signal some way adds to the feedback signal, and therefore if I look at the output of this summer, it can be expanded in a geometric series which says Vx is equal to V out Hj omega if at omega 0, at the frequency at which I am interested in, into V out Hj omega 0 square V out, and go on and so on and so forth. Now one can see from here, from this series, that if Hj omega 0 magnitude is larger than 1 positive quantity, then what will be the series look like? A diverging series, because each term will be higher than the last one. So it's a divergent series, and therefore in some cases this is called growth condition. So if something keeps increasing, and it will finally add to the saturation value whichever it reaches. But it's not oscillating, it's only going in one direction and may be saturating. The other possibility is Hj omega 0 is less than 1, okay, or minus. Then of course, as the term go ahead, they will start reducing essentially means, and one can say that this will be a converging series, and if there is a convergence in series, then one may say that somewhere it may go down. At some frequency it may happen that the series sum we can calculate, and one knows the geometric series has, let's say there are p terms, so 1 minus 1 upon 1 minus p is the sum of any geometric series. So I can evaluate for a such divergent series, converging series, the net sum value for this. This is what is my next slide is trying to show. The first part already I said, if Hj1 is a divergent series, where if it is less, Vx converges series representation and its magnitude is finite and can be given by 1 minus Hj omega 0, omega 0. We are only interested in the frequency at one frequency. This is the frequency where system will oscillate. That's what we are trying to find out. So what Barkhausen said about this condition, that if you have a negative feedback as shown there, and if your this Hj omega 0 is larger than 1, and if the condition second, that Hj omega 0 is 180 degree, then the system may actually, let's say this is minus sign, it should decrease. So this is the condition at which we have already seen, this is the condition for stability. If it goes up other side, system becomes unstable. So we are right now trying to see where system starts becoming unstable. Okay, we may see that this instability can be used to generate the signal, because instability means something is feedback and it keeps returning back. Now this Barkhausen criteria, which you have done in second year, I will not repeat again. Based on this thinking, I can make number of oscillators. Yeah, that you can read in second year book. This is just main important part you should look. If you have a single transistor and you have a single capacitor, okay, which may be the CDB of the transistor itself, okay, and maybe some output wire connections, then we see it has a single pole. It has a single pole which is 1 upon RD CL. We know at pole the phase shift goes 45 degree per decade. So the maximum phase shift which a capacitor can give is 90 degree J. Transistor will give you 180 degree out of phase signals, input to output. Since I am feeding it back, difference phase essentially 180 plus 90, that means 270. But for sustained oscillation, signal should return back to add or 0 degrees or 360 degrees, which is 360 is same as 0. So when the signal returns to same phase, then only it will start actually operating as an oscillator. So a single transistor with a capacitor does not give any oscillations. It is like a system which will die down at the end of the day and no oscillations can be seen. We said, okay, if that is so, I had two such systems connected in series. This is essentially the principle of ring oscillator. You have one inverter is feeding to the next inverter. You have one CL here, one CL here. Okay. So now you can see 180 plus 180 is 360. This is 90 plus 90. So total 180 out of 180, the return signal is 360 degrees. Is that correct? This is 90, 90 and this is 180, 180. So essentially now you are saying you are satisfying Barkhausen criteria that the sigma has to be 180 degree and we are satisfying Barkhausen criteria. However, we see this does not oscillate. Though it looks to that it is satisfying your condition of oscillations, but it is still not oscillating. This is what is it called essentially? This is a latch. Two inverters connected back to back is essentially a latch. Okay. So if you put one, the output of next is zero, if you get that zero, why this did not oscillate? Assuming that CLs are same, the loads are same. If you have a CMOS kind of inverter, what will be the output resistance of them? Very large ROs. So the gains will be GM times RO, or even here RD will be a few tens of kilo ohms. So it will be roughly large gains will be available from both these inverters. Now if there are larger gains, the output which you are looking at, okay, will be already reaching towards PDD, saturation values. So essentially what happens that even if you are satisfying the condition, the output becomes 1 or 0 depending on the, you know, if it is 1 here, it comes here 0 and it latches itself to 0, 1 combination, whichever it starts with. So it doesn't oscillate. Okay. So even if Barkhausen criteria is met, it is not always possible that system will be stable and the condition there is the gain is extremely high. If the gain are very small, this may be able to, and one of the oscillator will make is exactly this, that we will reduce the gains so low, then the system may oscillate even with two inverter systems. Okay. So this essentially is the feature which we want to utilize. So in most ring oscillators, how many stages you find? Always odd number of stages, 3, 5, 7 or whatever numbers. And we never put it even because that even will always reach to its saturation values and it will only latch up. Okay. It's like a shift register. Okay. And it will never be able to oscillate. Now this issue has been taken care of. Let's say I put now instead of two inverters, I put it three inverters. I have one inverter driving capacitor CL, all of them have same CL. Okay. If you look at these are amplifiers with Hj omega 0 as its transfer function, and this is AV0 essentially is the DC gain or low frequency gain. Kisi ko confusion ho to fir se bata deta hu. Very very low frequency gain or a DC gain. So a transfer function for individual, this will be AV skew upon 1 plus, because a triple pole, 3 of them, so it is AV0 and there is no feedback right now, it is only open loop system. So it is AV cube, each has AV, 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 0, and each have same pole at omega 1 upon RC. So we said there are triple pole at omega 0, 1 plus s by omega 0 to the power cube. This is called a triple pole system, and we would like to see, does this then provides an oscillations somewhere close to omega 0. It may not oscillate at omega 0, but where does it then oscillates? We can see, and that is what we are going to show later. Okay. If we say we can see that oscillation to sustain, we can figure out, this is the proof we will do, that the gain has to be at least 2 for per stage, and then the oscillator frequency will be root 3 times the pole frequency. Okay. This is what we should get, and we will try to prove that we probably get this value as we suggested. But however, it essentially is trying to tell that 3 capacitor must give you phase shifts of at least 60 degree per capacitor, so that the net is 180, total is 360 plus 360, 720. Okay. So you must get oscillations properly. Now how do I get each RC combination to give me a phase shifts of 60 degree? This is what the basic principle of designing a ring oscillator. Okay. But before we go to actually deriving these frequencies, let us look at this triple pole system with a negative feedback. Okay. Is that okay, everyone? It is trivial, but this is a proof I want to do it, but I will prove later that why I am right or I am wrong. Let us see whether I am right. Hopefully I am right. Okay. Is that okay? Let us say open loop system for a triple pole 1 is AV0, and right now I am not making cube, I am just saying AV0 is the net gain for triple system, which is AV0 upon 1 minus SP1. P1 is the actual pole, remember it is minus side it comes, so it is magnitude wise you can like this. So it writes 1 minus S by P1 to the power cube. I repeat again, AV0 is a DC gain, or if you wish call it a very low frequency gain. There is a confusion going on over the end of the course, so I have restarted rewriting that again and again. Okay, if this is your open loop amplifier gain or transfer function, and you get a feedback with a feedback of network of which gives you a gain of beta. And right now my assumption is beta is independent of frequency. So if I close loop gain, I look at it AOLS upon 1 plus AOLS time beta. Beta could be 1 or beta could be whatever network actually you want to create. You may have a capacitive network, you may have a resistive network to return back to the inputs. If you write closed loop gain AOLS upon 1 plus AOL beta, what I am now going to do is substitute this AOLS in this, okay, and then get the closed loop gain in terms of S by P1 and AV0 as we want to. Right now, as I say, AV0 is not individual, this total gain of the triple pole system. Later we say it may be cube, okay, because each stage will give equivalent of that. Okay. Okay, so is that okay, everyone? If this open loop amplifier gets a feedback with a network gain of beta, and beta is not a function of frequency, then the closed loop gain is OLS. What is the purpose of doing all this? I want to find a condition in which the oscillator frequency is decided by omega 0, which is essentially in my hand. Is that clear? Because RC is my time constant. I can get RC by design, and therefore I should be able to relate my oscillator frequency with the design parameter, which is the only thing which I have, maybe I also have a gain, but I don't really large gain, because we have seen if it's too large a gain, maybe I should reduce the gain possibility is one only requirement. Otherwise, I'm not very keen about gain so much as I'm worried about the conversion of omega 0 times something to the oscillator frequency, which allows me to actually design an oscillator of a given frequency of my choice. Okay, is that okay? So if I substitute here, of course this is has been done in second year, third year, wherever book you have studied. I am just repeating it again so that you once for all you get this clear how a triple pole system or maybe odd pole system actually gives you the oscillator frequencies. So if I substitute here, I can get AV0 upon 1 minus S by P1 to the power cube into AV, just this multiply here, this multiply here, and then you get this term. Now you can see from here, a loop gain can be defined as AV0 times beta T0. Remember, both terms are independent of frequency, and therefore it's called T0 is AV0 beta. Now at any other frequency also, we can find the loop transfer function, which is essentially T0 upon 1 minus S upon P1 to the power cube. This is essentially frequency dependence. This is essentially frequency independent term, okay, or low frequency term. So if I write this and I write that S is equal to j omega and then put P1 as its magnitude value, then it becomes T0 upon 1 plus j upon omega upon root P1, magnitude P1 to the power cube. This equation you keep, we'll use a little later. But since I was writing T0, I say we can also write Tj omega at any frequency in this fashion. Okay, I'll use this later on to prove that Bode's plot also gives the same result as the solution of this equation. What are these called? Which technique I am trying to show you? Solution of this equation of denominator is will give you roots, and the technique to figure out whether system is going to grow or not is decided by root locus technique. So I am trying to now bring back something which third year student must be doing control course or must have finished, no, next semester. Fourth year of course have done, okay, and MTech of course should say they have done, okay. They cannot say they are not done, except if there are few MSc students, then they may say, well, I have not done it. Okay, so we observe the poles for closed loop gain as the denominator solution equal to 0. Okay, so 1 minus S by P1, okay, you everywhere either plus 1 upon J times or put P1 like this. Then I get a solution from this, 1 minus S by P1 to the power cube is minus T0, or 1 minus S by cube root of minus T0. Iska equation aapko aana chahiye tha, par phir maine karke dikha diya ki how do people solve. Okay, this is a trivial maths, but I always realize that sometimes triviality has forgotten by many, so I solve for you. This essentially say, let's say x is equal to cube root of minus y, then I can write x cube plus y is equal to 0, or x cube plus y to the power 1 by 3 to the power 3. So this is like a cube plus b cube equal to 0. Okay. Which one? Oh yes. Okay, you are right, but that is irrelevant to right now. Okay. This minus will be taken care when the solution will come plus minus. Okay. Okay. Or maybe put a mod and put a sign plus, whichever way you look at it. So if I solve this, yes. Oh sorry. He is saying plus, so maybe I'll do this. Okay. No, I think that was correct, no? This 1 plus was correct. Why did you say so? If I bring it, 1 plus T0 was correct, in fact. Okay. Right now, whatever mod we'll see later. But 1 minus this, then this is 1 minus, sorry. If this is 1 minus, so 1 minus root 2 0 is correct. Okay. So 1 plus, okay, you are right. Okay, 1 plus now is correct. Sorry. So if I now have an equation which is x cube plus y cube, y to the power 1 by 3 cube, I can expand this x plus y by a plus b into a square plus ab plus b square. This is so known to every one of us. So there are three possible solutions out of this. One is x1 is minus 1 by y to the power 1 by 3, x2 is minus y to the power 1 by 3 e j pi by 3, and x3 is minus 1 by 3 a j pi by 3. Pi by 3 is root 3 by 2, or root 60 degree, so e to the power j 60 degree. So if I now substitute the poles s1, s2, s3, I will get p1 plus 1 plus root 2 0, p1 into e to the power this, and the other is e to the power minus j pi by 3. So these are called roots of the poles which you have actually wanted to find for the ACL. Please remember, this is for closed loop feedback, negative feedback system. We are still working on negative feedback system, okay, and we want to see, does that give you oscillation edge where it will start oscillating? After all, what is negative feedback is used for stabilizing something. So if I can get to the edge of instability, I may have growth condition starts, and we may say we have oscillation conditions met. So if you show this, maybe I can, have you done written down these expressions? So if I plot the root locus, that is I plot sigma against j omega for these three roots, please remember all three poles are at t is equal to that, we all were initially at the same point for the open loop system. Now if I change the t values, a beta values, for initial value 0, t 0, you have a pole at 1 which is minus of whatever that p1 value which we got, okay. However, if I get it e to the power j pi by 60 or pi by 2, 3, I see this is the curve for that. Similarly, for the minus 60 degree, this is the curve for that. At this point, that is say at where the j, this axis cuts at j omega axis, we now see e to the power this divided by this is the tan inverse or tan theta of 60 degree, okay. This is essentially a frequency omega 0 at which, what is the omega 0 definition was? We observe that omega 0 is the frequency at which this locus intersects j omega axis. So this frequency is omega 0. Clearly here the real values must vanish. What is a j omega axis? Real values must vanish. That's why it's called imaginary axis. So if I find the real value to be 0 from the expression which I have, one for this point, 1 minus real value of root 3 t 0 e to the power j pi by 3 must be 0. Solving this, I get t 0 equal to 8 at omega equal to omega 0. Okay. At omega equal to omega 0, the a beta requirement is 8 value. And if beta is 1 and there are 3 stages gains, how much should be individual stage gain should be? 2. Is that quite clear? So if you can now create an inverter or amplifying system which has a gain of 2, then at the same position, if you have triple pole equivalence, this will give some kind of a frequency at which system is now at the edge of instability and still at the j omega axis. This point we want to clear. From the root locus figure, this divided by this is how much? This is P1. This is omega 0. So tan 60 is omega 0 by P1 mod of that. Is that okay? Have you drawn? So if I substitute tan 60 is equal to omega by P1, then I get omega 0 is root 3 P1, 1.73 times P1. Is that clear to you? Now at this point, what is the frequency above omega 0? If you exceed little bit omega 0, sigma is slightly positive. As you cross T0 slightly more than that, you have slight sigma higher than 0, and imaginary part will only exist. Okay. This is like a positive feedback system which will show you growth response. So at this point ahead, there is a growth. Okay. So we should have gain not exactly 2, but slightly more than 2, okay, which naturally parasitics will allow you to get it. So you at that point you say system will start into equivalence of positive feedback. Is that clear? So a negative feedback system has been converted to a positive feedback edge system, you can say, by just adjusting the values of T0s. Is that clear? And the we can see typically if you look the solve that this, it is e to the power sigma t sine omega t is the growth equation for the waveform to grow. This is how it actually grows. Now we see from here, if this is so, then we can use, so we have figured out that the oscillating frequency starts at when A0 is roughly equal to, slightly more, but equal to 2 or rather 8 right now. T0 is A beta, which is 8. If you keep it, then you will be able to have start of growth system. Now we can also figure out this same frequency which we are talking about using a Bode's plot. Okay. Bode's plot can be plotted for the loop gain itself. Okay. So I will have you, if you finish this writing, then I will show you. I can do the same analysis using Bode's plot also. So what is the frequency it will start oscillating? Root 3 times the 1 upon RC, whatever you are fixing for yourself. R and C are within your hand and therefore you are fixing the oscillating frequency. Okay. And what is to be guaranteed? That T0 should be just about 8. Okay. Is that okay? So we can use, of course, this, as I said, this is not the part of this really course. We should have, anyway, everyone should know this. So we can use the Bode's plot for the loop gain. Ts is Tj omega, which I have already written a function. And then we plot the magnitude of Tj omega 0. And we also plot the angle, that is the phase for that, which we call the Bode plots. Please remember, each pole gives how much degrees per decade? 45 degrees. So there are 3 poles. So it should reach 135 degree at the pole position. Is that in the Bode plot at P1, frequency of P1, you must get a phase shift of minus 135 degree. We also know if Tj 180 is positive, that is the magnitude at 180 degree is positive. Is that clear to you? And phase has reached 180, your growth system. Is that clear? What is the stability of our criteria was? That if 180 should not reach before the gain goes to 0 dB. Here, gain is positive and you have reached 180 degree. Now let's see how it looks. So what is the gain fall? How many dBs per decade? Minus 20 plus minus 20 plus minus 20, minus 60 dB per decade, gain starts falling. Okay. So if I do this, I find the magnitude, which is the loop gain in dBs, is minus 60 dB per decade. This is my pole, 3 dB down point. Okay, and at this point, the phase should be 135. If I extend it because there is no other pole, it will go straight and then saturate by another 135 degree to 0 or minus 270. 135 here, 135 here. And somewhere here, we have phase of 180. W1, this minus 180, I extend it on the gain axis. So what is the gain margin now? Positive. You have this much gain available at W equal to W 180 degree phase. Okay, this at 180 degree phase minus 180, we have positive gain there. Is that clear? So what does this mean? What does this expression means? It means that the stability is disturbed, and if you can make that T0 equal to 8 as I started with, this point will get exactly equal to the point root 3 times the pole frequency. This is what essentially Bode also said so, and also the root locus method. The third method will be what? Nyquist criteria, take how many times minus 1, 0 actually encircled, you will get the same point again. If you wish, we can do that as well, but is that okay? So just look at it, either use Bode's technique or use root locus technique or use Nyquist criteria, and at the end of the day we figure it out that the oscillator frequency is root 3 times the pole frequency. Let us say if omega 0 is the pole frequency, then omega 0 tan inverse pi by 3 is root 3 by root 3 omega 0. So essentially what is it trying to say? At that point the loop gain becomes 1 when, okay, here is, let me redraw it. So we now return to ring oscillator. Okay, we now return to, okay, is that okay? Everyone has drawn this. Ek pole ke upar 135 lagao, usko niche tak le jao, 180 se fir upar jao aur dekho ki gain positive hua ki nahi. So this is the condition of oscillations. So we return to our case of ring oscillator. Omega 0 here is R out times CL to the power minus 1. Please remember, R out is normally the output this. If it is a RD kind, it is much easier to control omega 0, and A0 is stage gain. So HS is minus A0 upon 1 plus S omega 0 to the power 3. The net transfer function omega used here is omega 0. Each stage should contribute to 60 degree phase. Is that clear? That is what we said now. 60, 60, 60 must appear, so that total is 720 or 360 or 0, whichever you call, 180, 180, 180 plus 180. So you return back to original phase, okay, 0 or 360 degrees. So if you do this, I write omega OSC should be tan inverse pi by 3, 60 degree means pi by 3. So tan inverse pi by 3 is into omega 0 should be the, or root 3 times omega 0 should be the oscillator frequency, and at that time loop gain is unity. Okay, loop gain is unity. So I can, how can I design an oscillator? All that I have to design an oscillator is to decide my R and C. Okay, that is, for R is decided by in transistors by what? W by L. So CL is also decided by CS, because CdV and other capacitances are also area dependent terms. Is that clear to you? So adjust your CL and R such that you get oscillator frequency of your choice. That's how oscillators are designed. What is the typical A0 therefore you should have now for each stage? For a loop gain equal to 1 at this omega 0, what does that mean? A0 by 8 is, cube by 8 is 1, so A0 should be 2. Ring oscillator thus will oscillate at frequency 2 pi omega 0 into, sorry, 2 pi not omega 0 by 2 pi. So omega 0 root 3 by 2 pi if the stage gain is equal to 2. Each stage gives you a gain of 2, and then at this frequency ring oscillator will start oscillating. Clearly from earlier discussion, the triple pole case says that V0 is a some constant e to the power A0 minus 2 by omega. This is the growth equations into cos of, this is the expression for the waveform which you generate. See it more on the solutions. So So obviously if A0 is less than 2, it will start damping. A0 is greater than 2, uncontrolled growth may start, and A0 equal to 2, sustained oscillations will be observed. So a number of inverter stages should be always odd. Why? Because otherwise the net phase can never become 0. So if you have 5, this will be A to the power 5 by something, and it will still come to 32, it may come, and A0 may still be 2. Okay. And you keep on doing this for any number of stages. Typically in a large ring oscillators which we test, how much is typical in CMOS? The delay per stage, do you have any idea? What is tau per picoseconds? So now if you want a frequency, figure out how many stages you should have, so that n 2n plus 1 times so much will be the frequency of your ring oscillators. And to get that, W by L for each stage is adjusted by you. Is that clear? So the design is essentially only on the W by L and associated. Please remember CdB, which is the output capacitance of the transistor, is essentially is governed by area. See input, the next stage is also governed by area. Okay, and therefore whatever W by L you choose, please see to it, it satisfies both your current conditions as well as your capacitor conditions. Is that clear? So that the gain is 2 as well as you get the frequencies of whatever your choice is. This is the most standard square wave generator which we use in the case of digital hardware. Everywhere you find the easiest method of generating pulses are the ring oscillators. Just put large number of stages for lower frequencies. Okay. If you, anyone who is doing an MTech project or something, you must have seen, to test your process, we have one of the test area which we have created is the ring oscillator. What does it tell? I have 125 stage oscillator so that the time which it will require will be large enough, frequency is low, so I can exactly monitor my frequency, and by stage law I know how much per stage the delay is essentially coming, and that will decide my speed of the digital hardware which I am going to use. Is that clear? So one of the test block on any chip test area is always a ring oscillator, and typically it has 125 or even higher number of stages, simply because of what? Because the delay has to be measurable on a CRO, okay. Otherwise the inaccuracy in your measurement may actually cause the problem. And since you know the net delay, we know how much is per stage delay you have. So that is how ring oscillators are used as the test block for all digital signal processings, okay. Then please remember, all chips have one test chip itself. What is it? There may be many transistor areas or many components on a chip. Each representative of that is brought on the separate area of a chip. Okay. Each, like you have a D flip flop, so you have few D flip flops. You have adder, you have small adder there. Every block which I use in real life is actually brought for test, individual testing. So large pads are used to test individual blocks. Large pads are normally not available, so what do? You put a multiplexer there to use same pads one after the other, okay. This is how the test pads are created. Once every chip must have at least how many test areas, can you think? Kitne hona chahiye? Ek pure wafer mein kitne test areas hona chahiye? 5. Top, bottom, left, right, center. All variations are taken care. If it satisfies everywhere, you are well within your design to work at every possible thing. Is that clear? So please remember, chip when you make, many of students have been told, but they don't want to think that way. Whatever component you require first must be brought on the test chip. So test chip must be designed and put in the center, two corners and two bottom and lower corners, so that the test is performed before the chip is there, because chip will have no pad internal to test anything. Let's say there are number of register number, you can't probe there. So how do you know which part didn't work? Okay. So in real life, whether it is analog chip or a digital chip, the test chip area must be left for you. Sometimes even more tests are done, but at least these many tests are. Even for example, process test is done, whether the wave metal is going through down. So I have a small trenching which I did here, put a metal and actually two part I test whether continuity was okay or not. Okay. So all test things are always provided on a test area. Please remember, this is something no one tells, but I figure out my own student don't do it in spite of being told. So it's okay. I mean, I can't blame anyone. But that test is essentially, if you are really getting your chip fabricated and want to test, you apply input and nothing works, then what do? Just hope for the best every time. God may help once a while, but not every time. So test is something, and it's required a lot of thinking what testing we should do. Okay. So what is the best technique is, go to the earlier chips, find what test area they are used, implement all of them with your system. Okay. This is the game all of us have been playing, and no new things come. Okay. Our aim was not to do this theory as we did so long, that okay, why it should oscillate. Our interest was only in VCO, which is what we are going to use. VCO, as you all know, stands for voltage control oscillators. That means by changing the voltages, control voltages, I should be able to change the frequency. But why did I do all this? To once for all make it clear that from where everyone is bringing the theory to utilize and design of an VCO. The part which I did here has no direct bearing on my VCO designs. But as a concept, you all should know that how I actually get oscillations in real life and why I adjust gains to these values. Okay. Is that clear? So why two inverters things will never work as oscillator, because they immediately their gains are so high. Okay. So that is that clear? GMR0 is so high that A02 is already crossed long time. Okay. So this fact that there is no oscillations can be understood if you know what is the theory behind. Okay, so this is something I repeated what second year, third year students should do anyway or no. There are two kinds of oscillator which I didn't say here. One is called, which only generates sinusoids. The others which generate other than sinusoids. The names are relaxation oscillators or phase shift oscillators, the other way. But anyway, right now I have not separated all of them. I just want to use the normal sense VCOs. The two VCOs which generate the square waves, which are shown here, one is called source coupled VCO, which is also popularly known as free running multivibrator. Okay. The second is also similar like a ring oscillator, but it is called current starved. Now this word is very interesting, current starved. It doesn't have, I can draw more current, I want more current, but my current source or sinks are not providing me that. I am limited by someone else. Okay. My VGS wants this much current to flow, but the lower current source is, it sinks as it nahi. So these are called starved inverters. Okay. Okay. If you look at a VCO, all that I am asking is we should have V control, which will give me output frequency of my choice. Okay. So if you look at simple expression, omega 0 is a frequency when I say there is no control signal or zero control signal. Okay. It's called omega 0. Then I say omega out should be, this is equal to omega 0 plus k some constant times V control. So obviously the unit of this should be what? Something radian per second per volt kind of thing, because it should convert into radian per second. Okay, is that okay? This is the schematic of a VCO. This is what I want to design. Okay. Is it okay? Now what are the features of a VCO? If I plot the same curve which I just now, same expression W out versus V control, I have linear relationship. That means K is treated constant. I may vary the K, but K is slope which is constant. That means I can do this, but for given this, K VCO is the giving a slope for this curve. y is equal to mx plus c. This is the frequency omega 0 at which typically V control is close to 0, okay. Intercept as we call. Okay. So, we operate our VCO, say this center point, some ways call it VC, center frequency or center omega c is some kind of a center frequency, and V1 and V2 are on its left and right. So, what is the range in which this VCO will give me outputs? For V1 there is a frequency of omega 1 and for V2 there is a frequency of omega 2. So, I have a range of omega 1 to omega 2 as my tuning range. What is it called? Tuning range. So, for a VCO I should be able to tune at least in a band of say W1 to W2. Or to say the range is W2 minus W1, and on an average this is half of that is roughly the central frequency. It need not be exactly half because there is an intercept going on, but magnitude wise it should be roughly half. Okay. So from this expression I can write KVC0 is 2 pi f max minus f min, call it f max, call it f min, divided by V max minus V min, okay, is the called VCO gain. KVCO is called VCO gain. Typical power dissipated or used here in most VCOs is of the order of 1 to 10 milliwatts, okay, typical. That does not mean I cannot make low power or I can never make high power, but larger power will require larger currents and therefore larger W by L, so you will have a lower frequency down. So the given bands will have limited or some maximum minimum powers available. Generally VCO operation is 1 mega radian per second, okay, W max as a W minimum, and maximum be 10 mega radian per second, okay. Omega, these are radian per second is omega because it is say not F. Multiplied by 2 pi and you get, or rather divide by 2 pi and you will get frequencies. So for this typical values KVCO varies between 0 to 5 mega radian per second per volt. Let us look at the real characteristics of V control and W out, which is extended beyond this. Okay. This VC and this VC are not same. This is central and this is not central. So we say prior to this and ahead of the VCO frequency which you have, the relationship between V control and W out is not linear. Only in this region to this region KVCO is constant, ahead of it it goes down and goes saturates. Okay. So we say as long as KVCO is in linear this, that is the range of a VCO, maximum range. Is that clear? If this goes in the nonlinear area or this goes beyond this region, then the VCO will not operate the fashion in which I thought it should. Okay. So in real life, the characteristics of this to this relation is not linear everywhere for all frequencies. So the minimum frequency from which linearity start and up to the maximum frequency up till which the linearity is maintained is the actual VCO range. Is that clear? This is also VCO range, fair enough, for this actual max to min what you will do, but this is the ultimate limits. Beyond this or beyond this, VCO will not operate in standard W0 into K times omega kind k times V control. So we must, for a given technology, first two these markers are figured out. How much is the range in which my VCO can operate? Is that clear to you? So this is something physical range you know up to which you can really operate. If I plot W out by V control, and this may have a frequency dependence, so this is what it says. KVCO is constant and then it starts decreasing beyond those frequencies. Okay. So we say this is the range up to which V VCO should be used in your application. Corresponding to this frequency, whatever voltages are possible, only those voltages should be allowed to swing on. Okay, is that clear? So otherwise, you know, you may swing from 0 to 15 volt. What do we do? Okay, you may do it, but the system may not respond it because you may reach somewhere here. Our poles may start actually reducing the KV0 terms. Okay, is that point clear to you? These are something limits which many a times a priori should be known for a given technology. And once these known, then you can actually go to this curve and you know what is the value of this. This possibly is normally measured value. These are not derived values. These are normally measured value for an VCO. And this data is many times provided in your analog model models. Okay. Please remember, VCO design is very, very crucial in some other circuits. In RF, where do you think we need in RF circuits? I have shown you first few days, my many slides. Any receiver, when the signal arrives from antenna and you actually boost it through a low noise amplifier, that frequency may be very, very high and your processing has to be at digital low frequencies. So what do? We mix it with some other frequency which is close to this frequency and you create beat frequencies, okay, or you scale down that frequency by VCO tuning. So this VCO has to be a variable frequency so that I can tune out, okay. This is called the mixer, has one end as VCO, other is the signal, and that together will give me the output which is omega 1 minus omega 2, which is small frequencies. Okay. Of course, there is an image which needs to be rejected. Okay, so please remember, VCO is an essential part in any mobile system or any such system in which signals is received from outside. Okay. So this is why I thought that you should know you need VCO irrespective. The problem is, which probably I don't know whether we will be able to cover by Friday, if VCO changes its frequency because of the drifts, or I want this range to be different, then I should be able to synthesize another frequency out of same VCO. Okay. I want one frequency F, okay, range is over, but I want another range. Like in bands, in the case of mini, this you will have bands. So you want to tune different bands. What do? There is another circuit which is used, is called phase lock loops, which is also called frequency synthesizers. Okay. Normally you will be lower than the VCO, so you first design highest frequency VCO, keep dividing as much as you wish. Okay. This is required. So VCO is, the kind of VCO I am talking is more useful for digital applications, but so is true for any analog applications if needed. Before we start working ahead, let's have some terminology given in Radhavi's book, nothing much from my side. A mid-range value of a VCO is called center frequency. I already said, just a minute. In the range, somewhere in the mid-band, we call it center frequency, mid-range value. Then the second term, which is of relevance for a VCO, is decided by, it's called tuning range, and is decided by variation of VCO center frequency with process and temperature. Now this is another issue which I was just talking. Okay, you need stability, lock you should need. So you need to have a variation of VCO center frequency with process and temperature variation. It's limited by that. And the frequency range needed for an application. How much, which band you are working at and how much process variation and temperature will decide the range up to which circuit can give you proper performance. Now there is an issue which I don't know whether Radhavi has written, but I think I remembered it. Maybe he has written. We said that after all, the phase and frequency of any circuit will also be decided by the noise sitting on the control. Because if V control itself changes, other things will proportionately change anyway, isn't it? and that may be essentially how much noise it picks up. So we must be able to figure our frequency noise at the output, and which is proportional to k VCO. This noise output noise is proportional to the VCO gain. Larger the noise VCO, larger is the noise output you get. So what should I do to reduce this noise at the output? I should reduce the VCO gain, k VCO, because proportional to that. So okay, I reduce that value itself. But the tuning range was proportional to what? K VCO. So if you want a larger tuning range, I want larger k VCO. I want a low noise outputs, then I should have lower k VCO. This is the design. Is that clear? The two cases. One, you need higher VCO, k VCO for larger tuning range, and you need lower k VCO for lower noise outputs. Is that okay, this? So therefore there is a design issue, which how much noise you can tolerate and how much gain, see, frequencies limit you have. Okay. The third parameter of interest is the tuning linearity. Now we will see this later. Since the capacitance, the tuning is normally done by change in capacitance. So we can say KV0 is dV output by dVdD, how much is by power supply variation output changes, which can be written as D output or DC, where capacitance is a function of power supply voltage. Okay. What is this means? That if I change the VDD, my KVCO is not a constant quantity. So I am also worried how much it varies actually. The fourth term of my interest is, I need larger output amplitudes, because you want a larger oscillating signals, okay. But that may limit the gain part from that, because if that increases, you may get instabilities. So how much maximum amplitude I can reach before stability criteria is violated stringently, I mean excessively. Typical power, as I said, for VCO is around 10 milliwatt, 1 to 10 milliwatts. And you have to trade off between power, frequency and noise. So whatever we started this saying, this is still valid for even in VCO, we need to have trade off between noise, power and frequency. So you cannot have large tuning range, low power and low noise. There is nothing kind of like, it's like a triangle system. You stretch one, the other will reduce anyway. Okay, the last part for the VCO property, this is, I repeat, first was we talked about what? Center frequency, tuning range, tuning linearity, output amplitude, power, and last but not the least, last property of VCO, which is of relevance, is signal purity. Even with a constant KVCO and V control, that is no noise on V control, VCO is, KVCO is constant, output signal is not always periodic. There is still noise sitting over output frequency, output signals, both in phase and in frequency. These are called phase noise and jitter. The PLL essentially controls this. Phase lock loops essentially controls phase noise and jitter. Please remember, phase and frequency, frequency is time. So frequency domain and time domain, they seem to be different, but they are always connected. So one can figure out, not very straightforward way, if you are given a jitter, what will be equivalent phase noise, or given a phase noise, what will be equivalent jitter. Okay. Jitter is always in time frames, phase noise is like between the frequency domain. So is that okay to you? So these are the properties. So please remember, so we need an PLL at the end, because otherwise this will take care of this. Your noise part, which you thought is not there, even if you maintain KVCO and you maintain the control voltage, even then, okay. So this is very essential in any VCO design, which is the most common VCO, okay, also popularly known as multivibrator. Because you have worked mostly on the bipolar circuits, you will not immediately guess this is same circuit, but it is essentially a multivibrator and implemented in CMOS technology or NMOS technology. If it is a, this is all NMOS, if I wanted to make a CMOS, ये जो ऊपर के दो ट्रांजिस्टर हैं M5 एंड M6 वो P चैनल होंगे और उनका गेट कहाँ जाएगा, ग्राउंड के ऊपर. That's the only difference between a CMOS and a fully NMOS. I repeat, if I want to make a CMOS out of that, this M5 and M6 are P channel devices and their gates are connected to ground, essentially making them saturated either way. Is that okay? You can see from here what is I am trying to show you, that this M1, M2 are essentially controlled by the V controller, okay, for given W by L and excess voltage available to me for a given technology, they may give me current sources, okay, IDS1 and IDS2. If I make sizes VT same, these two currents will be also equal. Right now I showed you different, but in reality I will make them equal. I have connected a capacitor here. Why I need a capacitor? Because unless I create omega somewhere, I cannot create omega oscillations. Okay. Root 3 time omega 0 is okay, but omega pole has to be created. So here is one capacitor. Of course, right now in my analysis, because this is what generally everyone does, I have not taken up parasitics. But if you put all parasitics, this may go a little haywire and you need a simulation to perform. Okay, right now to make analytical thinking, we assume it could be one C constant. In reality, you will have to figure out net capacitance at these nodes, and that's the values you will have to figure it out. Okay. But theory wise, what is it happening? See, these are two current sources. Okay. For some reason, we'll see, we'll come back after, because it's all the time going. If one of them is conducting, let's say M4 conducting and M3 not conducting, okay. So there is no current coming from M3, because you said M3 is not conducting. This partly may occur because of the values which I get on V out bars, okay. If there is no current here and M4 is providing you a current, this requires IDS, because this transistor current source requires this. Now this is connected through a capacitor, so when I switch over from state, not only one current it has to supply to maintain this, but to maintain this, the other equivalent current must flow through the capacitor down. Okay. So how much current this should supply? Twice. So that's the theory we are looking into. Inverse happen, if this is on, off, and this is on, this must provide two IDS current, so that one IDS goes there and one IDS goes through capacitor to create. Let us say, for reason this is digital circuit and therefore M3 is on and M3 is off and M4 is on, fully on. No current goes through M3. If this current is coming from M4 from power supply side like this, this must maintain one IDS. Now this current source is connected to the other end and requires an IDS current. So when I am switching from this off means some value here and this I switch, this immediately at switch point must provide twice the current, one to go through this and one to go through down. Okay. So that means it must supply twice IDS currents. By same logic, if your inverse is true that M3 is on and M4 is this, M3 must provide twice IDS currents to go through these two, and then the capacitor will be charged like this or charged like this. Is that clear to you? This is essentially the feature of source, yeah, bistable element, and that is what bistable is. It's not bistable. Bistable is essentially it doesn't come out of it. It remains stable. Latch. This is not a latch. It is a stable, okay. Or rather it's called free running. Okay, so we will come in the evening and we will now study the waveform for this, also for the starred one, okay, and we will also look into other oscillators, time permitting, whatever.